Today in the news, we've got some AMD, some Google, and a little bit of Netflix. What's up, guys? I'm Snows, and this is your boot sequence. All right, so yesterday, AMD had their annual shareholders meeting. Did we learn anything new from it? Well, not that much. We already know that Navi is going to launch in Q3, but we didn't know about Ryzen, or at least we didn't have the official word from AMD. Well, now it's official. Ryzen 3000 and Epic will both launch in Q3, same as Navi. Since Q3 starts on July 1st and ends on September 30th, I think we all heard of a date that might make things extra special for AMD. July 7th. I mean, it's the perfect date. 7th day, 7th month, and it's for 7nm CPUs and GPUs. Here, we're talking about the release date, not the announcement date. We've heard that date before, and all it does is really solidify the leaks. Also with AMD, we got another user benchmark of the 12-core CPU. Now, this is the exact same CPU as the one we saw back in January, or at least it has the same exact engineering sample code, but things are a little bit different now. Just to be clear, there were two engineering samples leaked back in January, one on the 23rd and the other on the 30th. We're only going to focus on the one on the 30th compared to the one that we have now. So the base clock and boost clock are the same on both benchmarks, but what is definitely different is in the scores. While they both have the same score in single and full multi-core performance, the quad-core score is quite different. The newer benchmark has a 63-point advantage. This is probably AMD's precision boost in action. Between the first-gen and second-gen Ryzen, AMD revamped their precision boost algorithm to make it a little more linear and aggressive. Instead of boosting some cores and lowering the hell out of others, they went for a gradual decline of clocks. Maybe this time it'll be the best of both worlds, with more cores pinned to the max clock frequencies and then a gradual decline for the rest of the cores. The only thing is, this theory wouldn't explain the lower turbo clocks seen on the engineering samples. Another thing to note on that 12-core benchmark is the use of dual channel memory. The old benchmarks use a single 4GB stick of RAM clocked at 1333MHz, whereas this new one has 16MHz in dual channel with two sticks of 8GB. Other improvements like the speed of cache memory is also something that you can see on the user benchmark. We heard about a 12 and a 16 core Ryzen 3000 CPUs circulating around in the last few days. Apparently the 12 core has a very high clock speed, but this one is clearly not it. This seems to be an update of an older engineering sample. Moving on, it looks like all of the Intel vulnerabilities pushed Google to make some changes to Chrome OS.
Just a quick update on the situation. Apparently, Intel tried to bribe the Dutch university researchers with up to $120,000 to swipe the issue under the rug, or at least to downplay the severity of MDS. Anyways, just wanted to keep you guys updated. Let's get back into the news.
The latest vulnerability, called MDS, pushed Chromium developers to disable hyper-threading on the latest Chrome OS update. Chrome OS 74 will disable it by default, but if you're worried about performance loss, you could enable it using a specific flag. While Chrome OS devices are probably not the most powerful machines, stripping, for example, a dual-core CPU with 4 threads down to dual cores with 2 threads could impact simple things like YouTube 4K video playback, the switching between tabs in Chrome when you have a lot of them open, or just multitasking in general. The Chrome OS 75 update contains additional mitigations, but it's not clear if hyper-threading will make a return in any follow-up versions. Then we have something quite interesting coming from Netflix. It looks like they will join E3 this year. It was probably planned in advance, but one of the official Netflix accounts tweeted at E3 to get an invite, and the conversation brought us the title of the panel: Bringing Your Favorite Shows to Life, Developing Netflix Originals into Video Games. We already know that a Stranger Things video game is coming out, but apparently there is more. I think that it's pretty cool to see a move like that from Netflix, but I'm personally not interested in Telltale-style narrative games. I don't know if it's just the graphics that bother me, but if they hired a studio similar to Quantic Dreams to develop their video games, my opinion might change. Who knows? Maybe Netflix will even open up a user-based Let's Play streaming service on their platform. Let's hope not. Lastly, it looks like Google is going to shut down their Project Campfire. Project Campfire was going to allow an Alt OS to dual boot on Chromebooks. That Alt OS was believed to be in reference to Windows 10, since a lot of the code mentioned Microsoft services. With the I/O event that announced the compatibility of all future Chromebooks with Linux, things started to change in the Chromium project code. Comments and sections of the code that made references to Alt OS or Campfire were being removed. It's a shame because Chromebooks, especially Pixelbooks, are quite nice. If you could pick one up used with an Intel processor, it might have been a fine laptop with the capability to run Windows 10, Chrome OS, and Linux. Alright, so, I'm sorry this video is a little bit late on the news. I got quite sick yesterday and ended up sleeping almost 14 hours. But I'm fine now. This concludes it for today though. Hopefully you've enjoyed. If you have any questions, leave them down below. I'll be there to answer. As usual, you can click right here to see the latest video, right here to subscribe to the channel. It would be greatly appreciated. Stay frosty, and I'll see you guys on the next one.